pressure, tries to take its claim over my heart. All right, Cultivate, good morning, everybody. It is good to be in the house of the Lord, 1045. It is so good to be here. My name is Justin. So glad you guys are here to worship with us, to get to know the Lord more. Maybe it's your first time visiting. We are so thankful for you being here. Everybody online as well, as you're tuning in, welcome, welcome, welcome. So right now, there's a lot of new faces right here in this place. So right now is a good time for us just to say hello to someone in our row. Stand up, say hi, make sure you say your name. Talk about your plans for the weekend as we go into that. Church, again, so welcome to this place. And so one thing we do here every week, for those of you that maybe are new and maybe obviously it's your first time here, I like to just read out of scripture. You know, I believe and we believe in this place that God's word is active and moving. It's not just one of those books you just read and then you kind of put it on the shelf and say, that was a really good book. You know, maybe some other time I'll read that again. It's something you read every day and he speaks to you through it, in and through it. And we actually have Bibles in the back as well. If you ever need one and want to take one home and keep one, they're there for you. So feel free to do that today as well. But we're going to read out of Mark. We're in this series, The Jesus Creed, love God, love people. And that's what we want to do, is we want to love God first and then learn how to love like he loves us. And so we're going to read this creed together. This is the greatest commandment that Jesus gave us. And so I think it's really important just to memorize this and keep this in your heart as you go forth from this place today. But we're going to read this together with a little bit of enthusiasm like we did a couple weeks ago. And we have another week of doing this, but it's just such an important verse for us. So this is going to be Mark. This is going to be 29, verse 29. Here we go. You guys ready to do this together? Can we do this nice and loud? Loud and proud? Here we go. The most important one, answered Jesus, is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Even louder, come on. The second is this. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. There's something really powerful about just the church collected and saying these things, saying these truths in this house right now. This is God's house. We are all here. This is safe, a safe place for you to be right now. This is holy ground. There's no evil here. It is only God and his people and us just bowing before him, saying, God, you are good, and there's freedom in you, and I want more of you. Amen? Let's worship together. Come on. We sing, oh, 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 oh. When I'm walking through the valley, your presence is around me, 'cause nothing stands between me and my God. In the fear that was my prison, no longer where I'm living, 'cause nothing stands between me and my God. Nothing. Yeah, there's no place I go that he is not. He's here. Come on.
And where the Spirit of the Lord is, well, there is freedom. And we'll be dancing through the darkness, cause we believe it. And every stronghold has to break at the name of Jesus.
It's true.
Cause where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Joy cannot be taken, cause nothing stands between me and my God.
Look at him this morning.
So I'm looking to Jesus through a veil that's torn to pieces, cause nothing stands between me and my God. Oh, where the Spirit of the Lord is, well, there is freedom. And we'll be dancing through the darkness. The name of Jesus, for where the Spirit of the Lord is, yeah, there is freedom. Oh, so watch the lies break off, watch the enemy flee, and watch the walls come crumbling down when the people of God sing.
Come on, church,
and hear the heavenly roar. Every heart set free. Hear the chains of shame hit the ground when the people of God sing.
Sing.
Watch the lies break off.
Yes.
Watch the enemy flee. Watch the walls come crumbling down when the people of God sing. You hear the heavenly roar.
Truth and in faith in this place, amen. You know, I don't know what you came in with today, but God does, and we believe that he's a mountain mover, and when we say, God, help me, he's always reliable, and so we're just going to claim that for us today, and we're going to claim that as a, you know, as a staff, as a worship team over you. If you don't believe it and you're doubting, we're saying we're going to believe that for you, because we're a family, and we care for one another, and so we're just going to sing this together, and we're going to remember that he can always make a way in your life. And it might not be the circumstance that you wanted. It might not be the way you thought it would be. But we're going to believe in faith, in the truth, in the life, which is in Jesus. We're going to say, yes, he can. Amen. Let's continue to worship.
Sometimes I wonder, is he faithful? And does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. And can he rescue? And can he save me again and again? But when I look back,
yeah.
Yes, he did. So yes, he
Sometimes those voices try to tell me that I've forgotten and I've fallen too far from His hands. But I know what kind of God He is, and I'm trusting in His promises. I'm believing and I'm singing, yes, He can.
Come on now. Hands together like this. Come on.
Did He move every mountain? Did He part every sea? Yes, He did. So yes, He can. Ooh. Did He defeat the darkness? Did He deliver me? Yes, He did.
Oh.
So yes, He can.
Ooh.
Did He move every mountain?
Believe in that in faith right now. Yes, we are. It's good for the church to be here right now. We're going to learn about Jesus in just a little bit. And Pastor Corey has an awesome message for us. But this time we want the kids to learn about Jesus as well. The kids are dismissed at this point, and we got volunteers waiting for them right through those doors, ready to take care of them.
Good morning. That's better. Hey, guys, I'm Carrie, and I'm the Family Life Director here at Cultivate, and I just am so glad every Sunday morning to be here with you guys and to be able to worship with you. We have a couple QR codes on the screen. If you are new here or if you don't get our weekly emails, I'd encourage you to scan this one or fill out the welcome card in your program, and we would love to get to know you. We'd love to make sure that you guys have the information you need to be able to be part of the life of this church. The other QR code has all of our announcements, all the ways you can get involved, all the things we're doing in this church. Both of those QR codes are also in your program. And I would invite you to take time to look at those each week. We come up and share a couple things with you, but there's so much going on in this church, and we want you to be a part of it. If you've been coming to this church for any amount of time, you know we do three things. We gather, we group, and we go. And I don't know about you guys, but I've been in churches before where all I did was gather. And I came and felt like a stranger, and I left and felt like I had been with strangers. And it's not until we engage in the group and in the go that we start to feel like we have community. And so I want to invite you to do that. I want to tell you a little bit about each of those things today, just some things coming up. As far as gathering, we have a great opportunity right after this service to head to Ridgepoint. Our three churches are coming together, and we're going to hear from Scott McKnight. He's the one that wrote the book, The Jesus Creed, which is what we've been going through over the past several weeks and what our sermons are about as well, and we get the chance to hear from him. So we want to invite you to come do that. Even if you haven't been reading the book, come. He'll have some great things for us to hear. Lunch starts at 12, but don't worry, like, the program doesn't start until 1. There is childcare available as well, so you can head out there right after the service and join us and be part of that. One of my favorite things that we do as we gather, one of the things I love to celebrate is Baptism Sunday, when we get to hear the testimony of how God has changed the lives of the people in our midst. The next baptism Sunday is coming up on February 19th. And if that's something, if you're starting to feel the nudge of like, this is maybe the next step for me, I want to invite you to talk to Amy Ridema after the service. If you don't know who that is, find any staff person. We can help you find her. But she'd love to have a conversation with you about that. Like I said, it's so important that we group together. We get to know each other better. There's all sorts of men's and women's Bible studies that are going to be starting off in the next few weeks. And those are all, you can find all the information with this QR code. But one that I want to highlight is Rooted. Rooted is a 10-week study where you get together with a group of people. And if you are kind of feeling like, I don't really know many people, this would be a great step for you. Everybody that I talk to that comes out of Rooted is like, I just feel like I now walk into this space and I like have family. And so it's a great thing to be involved in. Check it out. That starts up here in the next couple weeks as well. And as far as go, I want to highlight a couple things that our family life ministry does to send people out and to reach our community and our world. Something that we're doing in children's, every year we do the princess dance, and we see about 750 girls, dads, grandpas, uncles gather together for a really fun event. And we do that for the families in our community, in our church, but we also do it for people who maybe don't feel comfortable coming to church yet. It's a great first step to invite them into this night and to send them home with information and an invitation to come back and join us. So do that event. We do need some help. We are in charge, Cultivate is in charge of the food this year, and we just need people to help prep food throughout the day on Saturday. So if you have a couple hours to give, would you sign up in the back at Next Steps? We could really use that help. And for student ministries, the way we go with them is, one of the main ways is through student missions in the summer. We take 60-plus kids on our middle school trip, which is local. They serve all sorts of local organizations in Hamilton, Saugatuck, Holland, Zeeland, and it's so fun to watch them learn and grow and serve locally. And we take our high schoolers out of state. This year, they're going to Summersville, West Virginia, where they're going to serve people stuck in extreme generational poverty, and we're going to fix some houses. And it costs about $600 to take every student along with us. And we could use your help in sending them. So on March 12th, we're doing a fundraising dinner and auction in this space. It's going to be a fun night for families. We're going to have tacos. Who doesn't love tacos? So we're going to invite you to come out and join us and support our students in sending them to go serve Jesus and to make him known through the relationships that you build with these families. So at this point, I'm going to turn it back over to Justin.
Thank you, Carrie. And for those of you that don't know, those QR codes are just super important. You can just pull out your phone and just kind of snap it. You know, like you're going to take a picture and it's going to take you right there. And for those of you that are like, you know what, I'm not bringing my phone in this place, that's super cool too. I totally respect that. We're living in a digital world, so we're just trying to kind of appease both things there. So we have physical copies of our connections as well for you guys to get connected. The devil hates when we get connected together. He hates that, and God loves it. And we want to be like God. We want to be like Jesus, and so we want to connect with one another and love on one another. So thank you, Carrie, for those announcements. You know, we're going to worship in here just a moment. Again, through singing, we're also going to worship through giving at this time. And, you know, it's so important and critical for us in our faith, in our walk, in our journey, that we realize that we all worship something. You know, maybe it's your job. Maybe it is money. Maybe it's, you know, your spouse. I have no idea. Maybe it's yourself, which is a really dangerous place, right, to be, just worship of self. And we're here to worship Jesus. We're here to worship our God, our creator, and our sustainer. And so when this bucket kind of passes, you know, everything he's given you is a blessing from him. He's the blesser of our lives. And we're committing to that truth as well today. But it could be $5, it could be more than that, but it's your heart. He's checking for our heart and our motives right now during this time of worship. Even when we sing, not just about money, not just about giving or our time. Even when we sing, it's like, do we mean these lyrics? And then ask the Lord to help you. Help me learn these lyrics. Help me realize like who I am worshiping. And it's power in that. There's power in these lyrics as we sing together. So the ushers will come forward at this time. And right now, it's time for us to worship the Lord through singing and through giving. Let's stand, church, right now, and let's worship together.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out, working all things out.
One time.
Yes, I will lift you high in the Never fails, will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. In the waiting, the same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley.
Thank you for this beautiful day that you provided for us and this opportunity to gather together as the church and worship you and praise your name. God, I just pray for Corey as he delivers this message that you put on his heart, and I just pray that it would speak to us as a church, as a congregation, and as we go throughout this week, that we would be focused on you and focused on your love, and just that those are the things that would pour out of us to the world around us, is just your perfect love, God. Let's just hold on to that this week. Amen. You guys can be seated.
Good morning. So glad that you decided to come today. I wanted to tell you that when I was a kid, just a wee little one, I realized that it was really hard to be good, like, for any amount of time. And I thought, well, maybe if I, you know, as I grow older, it'll get easier. You know what I found out? It's impossible to be good all the time. I can't do it. I was growing up, and I'm like, I can't seem to go and have a good relationship with God, because I keep sinning. Like, I don't even know what to do with that. So as I grew older, I started to realize I have a problem with sin. Like, it's a moral problem. And I can't just win by trying harder. I tried that. And this is the thing about what Jesus did. And in Romans, I think it's spoken really well. Listen to these words. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for me and for you, for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And this is the gospel here. Like, we're in a position of a problem. Every one of you, by the way, has a problem with sin. I don't even need to know you. And I can see it. Because it's a reality that we all have. And so we're all in a spot where we need a Savior. We're all in a spot where we need to deal with our sin. And Christ came from heaven to earth and said, I will address sin for good. And I'm going to take care of it for you. Because you can't do it even if you try harder. It can't happen. And I will be righteousness for you. I will follow all the law. We speak of the Jesus Creed and the idea of loving God with all our heart and with all our soul and mind and strength and then loving others. And every one of us has failed that. So what do you do with that? Who's going to pay for the sin? And Jesus says, I will come and I'll take care of it for you and for you and for me. And I'll do it because I love you. I want a relationship with you. I want you to be with me for eternity. And we receive that. And it's a beautiful thing. So if you're here today and you heard that for the first time, like, it's an amazing gift. You can't earn it. You can't earn it. It's something that you have to ask Christ, and he will give it to you. And so we go through our life knowing that we have a new identity, knowing that we're forgiven. But God says, I want you to know that on a regular basis, you need to be reminded of what your sin is and what we need to do about it. And so communion is what we do. So we have communion today. And the idea of communion is that you recognize and know and understand that your sin has a price, has a cost, and that it's been paid for. And so we do this on a regular basis, and Jesus started this whole process, this whole beautiful symbolism with his disciples. And in Matthew 26, he's with his disciples in the upper room, and he's getting ready to go to the cross. He says, this is how it's going to work. While they were sitting, eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, and he says this, take and eat, this is my body. Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. So Jesus says, this is going to happen, and it's beautiful to experience together. We don't do this on our own at home by ourselves. He's like, no, I want you to do this together. So you recognize together, you're all in the same spot. You're all have the same problem, by the way. You're not good enough. And that's okay. Because we're all in the same spot where we can receive this beautiful gift and remember it. So what is it that is in your life right now? Is there some sin in your life? Is there some things that you just have to give over to God and give it to him? He says, give it to me. I'll take it. I'll take it. Both your sin of your past, right now, and the future. You can receive that. And this symbolism is so good because it has to be dealt with. And he says, my body's been broken for you. So I want us to do this together in a little bit different way today. We're going to have... Justin's going to play a beautiful song that we can reflect on. And as we come up, when you can come up whenever you want, we have stations. And at these stations, you'll see bread that you'll tear off. And as you tear it off, somebody will say, Christ's body broken for you. And then you'll take the bread, and then you'll dip it into the cup. And that person holding the cup will say, Christ's blood shed for you. Then you'll eat it and receive that beautiful thing, that symbolism. So when we do that, I want you to know, like, if you're on the ends here, there's a table against the wall there and a table against the wall on that side. You can grab that, and then imaginary line right down the middle here, and you can do that table and that table, and it should go nicely. But don't, like, nobody's forcing you to do this. Like, this is something that you just know that it's a beautiful gift, and you can receive it and take it. And Christ didn't die for no reason. He dealt with everybody's sin. And so it's a serious matter. So I'll reflect on that. And then how much do we glorify God because of his gift to us, right? And that's one of the reasons why we praise God. So take this minute, reflect on it, embrace it, and may we do this together in a wonderful spirit of receiving this gift.
Love is not proud, and love does not boast, and love after all matters the most, and love does not run, and love does not. Love does not keep locked inside. 'Cause love is a river that flows, and love never fails you. Love will sustain, and love will provide, and love will not cease at the end of time, and love will protect, and love always. And love still believes when you don't. Love is the arms that are holding you, and love never fails you. Nothing is greater than this, greater than this. love is right here. And love is alive. And love is the way, the truth, the life. Love is the river that flows through me. Love is the arms that are holding me. Love is the place you will fly to. And love never fails you.
Lord, thanks so much for the symbol and the way that we can come together and be on the same ground at the foot of the cross, needing a Savior. Lord, we thank you, and we pray that you will help us now to learn and grow. In your name, amen. You know, that's the thing, that after this message and receiving this this gift, it's not like God is done. He doesn't say, okay, I got you in the family, now go ahead, go play and have fun. He says, no, like, now you're in the family. I have a plan for you. I have a mission for you. I have something that I want you to do. It's specially designed just for you. Do you believe that? And that's what we struggle with sometimes, is that we receive it, and then we grab it, and then when we don't really know what to do next, and we end up trying to figure out how to combine what God wants us to do in the world, and it's just messy. And the idea of loving God in this world and then loving people, it's messy, and this isn't a new problem. It's a real problem. And so sometimes I wonder, how important is it really for us to, you know, reflect God's love? He wants us to reflect his love. You'd be image bearers. Did you know image bearers meaning reflect God's love? As I have given you love, I've sacrificed myself for you. I want you to reflect that everywhere. And how serious is he about that? Is that big of a deal? And how should we live? How important really is it? Well, in Corinth, Paul was teaching these new Christians to figure out just that. He's trying to help them say, okay, you received this gift, and now you're going to go out and try to reflect God's love, and you're struggling. And so he gives all these practical thoughts. He writes this letter to them and tries to help them see the difference between God's love and the idea of the world's and human and fleshly love, and contrast the difference. And because they're struggling, they're new believers, but they try to take what God has given them, the gift, and then they try to implement it in their culture. They try to work, because they're still here trying to move toward God, but they're still here, and they don't really know how it all works. And Paul confronts them and says, I want to give you some practical tips on how to worship, how to do this new life, because truly you are on a trajectory. You are not left alone after this. And so he confronts them in 1 Corinthians 13. We're going to read this. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give it over my body to hardship that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. See, the church in Corinth, they were doing amazing things. They were prophesying, they were speaking in tongues, they were helping the poor. But here's the thing, they were doing it, and they started to do it selfishly. They started to do it, and it gets tainted. And next thing you know, Paul says, look, if you don't do this with this pure love from God, it's worthless to me. I don't want it. I don't want any of it. It's just worth nothing. Now, that's kind of serious, isn't it? Because a lot of times we think, well, I'm good to the poor. I give stuff. Like, I'm nice. If you do it without this pure love, without that, the motive, he's like, I don't want any of it. It's worth nothing. Now, that should make us think a little bit, shouldn't it? Shouldn't that make us, like, pick our heads up and say, okay, look, maybe I should check my motives. Maybe I got to figure this out. And then he says this. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Now, maybe you've heard this at a wedding before. You've heard this maybe, and now you're picking up on it. It's like, okay, that's what love is, but that's God's love in contrast. And it's like, how do we know we're loving well right here? This is the measure. This is the measure. How do we know? If this is what love is, how often do you look like that? How often do you look like that kind of love? Is it every day? Is it once in a while? Do you feel like you really, got it figured out? Like, this kind of love, I think, is really challenging. Patience is a problem for Corey. It's a problem. In conversation, if I don't feel like somebody, like we're not on the same page, I get frustrated sometimes. I'm realizing I need to work on this. Some of you are maybe have an issue right now with envy. You don't like who you are, maybe, or what's happening, but you see that person's got what you want, and you have an issue right now, and it's kind of like you don't want to admit it, but it's there. So you pretend it's not there. It's not proud. It doesn't dishonor others. It's not self-seeking. How many times, friends, how many times are we kind to get something? Some of you are like, oh, no, I've never done that, Corey. I've never been nice to get what I want. No, my kindness is pure and beautiful. Right? Like, the reality is we do many things, loving things, for the wrong motives, if we're honest with ourselves, don't we? And it's true. And that's the idea and the struggle for the church in Corinth, and quite frankly, I think us. We struggle. So I think that as we struggle, I was hoping to maybe have a picture of, because I enjoy word pictures that I can see. I'm a visual learner, and so some of you are too, maybe. So I drew this incredible drawing here. You may want to take a picture of it, frame it or something. Actually, there was a young girl who came to me after the first service with a picture, and she drew it way better than me. I was like, that's really good. Like, but the idea here, and follow this thought, is that when you become and decide to accept this gift, this beautiful gift, God doesn't leave us alone. And he has a job and a role and a mission for us. And one of the biggest things is whatever we do, we have to do it with the love, right? With this kind of wonderful, beautiful love. And this love here, patience, kindness, protects, it always trusts and hopes, forgives. This is the fruit. Do you notice I drew a heart? Huh? Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day, okay? I'm trying to be cute here. And we have this beautiful fruit that we're supposed to be producing. And this Christ is the vine, okay? And I didn't just make that up. There's actually biblical proof showing that the vine is the right way to think about this. But the first thing you have to do is get your identity straight. And then Galatians 5 says this, those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. So you have to, what Paul is saying is you have to crucify the flesh, the world. Crucify all of these selfish desires. We are in a bad spot. We talked about this before communion. We're all in a bad spot. You have to crucify it and kill it, and you have to become this new creation. You have to kill it. And then next week is baptism. We're actually saying you put to death your old self, and you become alive in the new self, being born again. That's why I say raised to new life, because you are attached to the vine now. Christ is the vine. You become attached to that family, attached to this vine, and so you'll never be the same again when you're attached to him. You will learn immediately about this pure love, this type of love. But the same problem with the church in Corinth, you still have all this other stuff, right? Remember, that you grew up with or your family or whatever, and you're just like, these don't play nice together, do they? They don't. So remember first, when you fail, you're like, no, I'm part of the family. I'm on the vine. It doesn't feel like it right now, but I'm on the vine. And it says here, Jesus talks to his disciples, and he gives this picture. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. Think about that. Christ says, I'm the vine. My Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. Remember the fruit of the Spirit. This is the fruit that he's talking about. This beautiful love that we can give and that we are. And he says here, I am the vine. And you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. What Jesus is honestly saying is, apart from me, you can't do any of this. You can't do it with pure motives. You can't do this the right way with true love. You may think you do. You may think you do, but it's all twisted up in this, in the world, in this messiness. There's little glimpses of some things, but the motives are wrong, and you can't do it apart from me. You have to remain on the vine. I am the vine. You are the branches. This is you and I. We're these branches coming out, and he wants us to produce the fruit. What's interesting is if you grab a piece of fruit, let's say an apple, and you take a big bite out of it, and it's really good, you don't look at the apple and say, like, how'd you become that way? You go, who grew this? Who's the gardener? Who's the person that created this beautiful fruit? Right? The Father is the gardener. Sometimes we got pride get in the way when we have this fruit and we eat it and we actually think it's us. The fruit says, I did this. No, you didn't. You really didn't. You had nothing to do with it. Like, because you remain in me. That's how you get to this. And I can tell you that this may come as a shock to you, but I don't have this all figured out. Like, really, I struggle with this. Even this week. I had a conversation this week with somebody, with a couple people, and I left the conversation and I thought, Corey, you were aggressive there. You were frustrated. And as I'm driving home, I'm thinking about this. Then I'm like, well, they deserved it. Like, they wanted to know, they needed to know that they were wrong, and I let them know. Okay? And then as I'm driving farther, I'm like, I feel like God's saying, is that right, Corey? Is that how you think it's supposed to go? And I'm like, well, I don't know. Maybe you should reach out and say sorry. Oh, no. No. They've done way worse things than me. If I say sorry, they're going to take advantage of me. You ever go through these thoughts in your head, or am I the only one that does this? Right? And then, what are you going to do about this? This stuff sets in, doesn't it? It sets in. And how are you going to approach it? Humbly or with pride? You see, the person without good love will point the finger back at somebody else. I love my wife. She's great at helping me prune. Anybody else? Like, pruning is good. My wife is so good at helping me learn this, honestly. I don't like it sometimes, but she's very good at help pruning me. And if you have a good friend or good relationship, this is what they do, by the way. You make each other stronger, don't you? You do. Because love is not safe. It's not a feeling. True love, you get into the dirty, messy with true love. Didn't Christ come and die for us? What kind of love is that? Is that a safe love? You know? No. He went right down into the dirtiest of sin and said, I'll take it because I love you. I will get in there. Now, here we are, dancing between the two. You have decisions to make. What will you produce? I have a couple tips. Sometimes it's good to speak it out loud. On the way home, on that day, I actually said, Corey, get it right. I actually said that. Get it right! And then I was like, okay. So I did. I texted them and said, I'm sorry. You made me do this. I'm just kidding. I didn't. Isn't that a nice apology? Have you ever heard that before? That kind of apology? I'm sorry you made me do that. Maybe you'll do it right next time, and I'll behave properly. No, I said, my heart hurts because I don't feel like I was in the right kind of love, you know, when we talked. And I let some things get in the way, and I'm sorry. And their response was amazing. Their response was this. So every fear I had, they responded back, and it was wonderful. In fact, the person later said, boy, that was really good that you did that. Like, I like that you just keep short accounts. Like, take care of it. Don't sit on it. So speak it out loud. Check your motives. When you're feeling a certain way, when you're feeling any one of these right here, when you're feeling evil, proud, envy, selfish, bitterness, angry, when you, because, by the way, we cannot not feel these. Like, this is part of life. In our humanity, in our flesh, something happens, we feel a certain way. But when you feel this, ask yourself, why do I feel this way? Why do I feel this way? Why am I angry? Why am I feeling selfish? Why am I envious? And then ask God to correct you. And you'll end up, I believe, because you're attached to the vine, you're going to be given good answers. But do you see how if you are bitter or angry or unforgiven, like you haven't forgiven somebody, you cannot receive that. I've seen so many people, friends, that are bitter, can't grow fruit. Did you know that He wants you to grow much fruit? And when you're angry or bitter, you cannot grow fruit. I have seen this. I spoke to a gentleman one time about it. He was deeply hurt by the church. And we're sitting there talking, and he says, I'm sorry, Corey. I'm angry, and I'm bitter. I said, you are. And I said, what are you going to do about it? He goes, I don't know. But I can't let it go right now. I can't let it go. And it's the hardest thing, isn't it? The most loving thing is to have the courage to forgive, right? What did Jesus do while we were sinners? We didn't have to clean up first, and then he says, oh, I'm glad you're behaving now. Now I'll die for you. No, he's like, I'll do it before. I'll make the first move. And true love forgives. Now, I'm not saying to you that there's not discipline, because what did God say he does? What does the gardener do? He prunes and cuts. That's painful. If you were a gardener, have you ever tried to grow something outside? What do they say to do with the fall and right in the spring? You're actually cutting. You're hurting it. You're cutting, and it feels. Now, if the plant were alive, you'd be like, "Oh, you're cutting me. You're hurting me." It's like, no. I want you to grow. I want you to grow. So I got to cut and prune, and it doesn't feel good. But that's what truly humble people do: is they receive it well. They receive it well, and they discern. And they ask, okay, this person said I need to correct something. I'm a little angry at that. Why? And you know what? Honestly, I'm kind of angry because they're right. And I don't want to admit that they're right. Like, you see how that works? And then you go and say, you're right. I need to make a correction. Like, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful process if we do it together and as a church. And if you're young, and you learn this, you will grow immensely. Paul even talks about that. When you're young, you struggle, but when you grow older, you must conquer this. You must understand your identity and your projection to be this beautiful fruit in light. So conquer it, friends. We do this together, and that's why, like Carrie was talking about the group and the go, like we continually have to help each other. Because by ourselves, we're just lost in so many ways. And you can do it. You can continue to improve. I can continue to improve together, being attached to the vine. Let's pray. Lord, help us right now. We understand, like, we have some things to work on, and it feels overwhelming. In fact, some of us may even feel like, Corey, I don't even think I'm on the vine anymore. Like, I don't even think that I... My relationship with him is so difficult. If you need to know, like you are, Christ died and you're on the vine, and receive it today. Receive this identity, and that he can clear the way for new growth. We praise you, Lord, and that's one of the reasons why we have songs to just be thankful for what you've done, and may we glorify you now. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Corey. So for those of you that maybe are new, maybe you didn't know this, and maybe like today it was just like with communion and weird words like that. It's like, what is communion? What does that word mean? Like, we just love that you're here and you're learning and growing. We're all on a different journey, and God has worked in his perfect timing according to his purposes where we are in this life, in this space right now. But you're here for a reason today. And so maybe you just need to hear that from me. Like, we love you, he loves you, and you're here for a reason today. And we're growing together, we're family. Like Corey was saying, we group together, we go together. And so with that said, one of the things we offer every single week is we have a prayer station to my left and to your right. And these are people that are called by God to pray over you. And they just wanna receive your prayers and to pray with you, pray over you. We're here to do that as well. You know, maybe you're just confused on like, I don't know about this stuff. Like, I don't know theology and all those things. That's okay. It's totally okay to be where you are today, because God has brought you this far right now for you to learn and grow and he's going to do the pruning in your life, right? And so we would love to pray with you this morning. If you're online as well, we'd love to chat with you. Just like message us or email us. Feel free to reach out. Just say any prayer over these things. And maybe there's some things you want to celebrate. We love hearing good things too. But with that said, we would love to pray with you. And we're just remembering in this place as we kind of close in worship today, that he's brought you this far, and he will continue to bring you through your circumstances. It might not be what it looked like, or what you thought it might look like, but he's always bringing you through it. And so we're remembering that not just some of our hope, not just a little bit of our hope, but all of our hope is found in Jesus Christ. He's the sustainer. He is the one that knows everything. And so we're just gonna lean on that and not our own understanding in this place right now as we sing together, declare the goodness of God as the church, receive prayer together. We are a family, and he is our hope. Let's stand together. Let's worship together. Come on, church.
been held by the Savior, and I fell far from above, and I've been down to the river, and I ain't the same, a prodigal return. I've worn shackles and chains. I've been freed and forgiven. Yes, I have. I'm not going back, and I'll never be the same.
Thanks so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it, and we just want you to have a great week. Will you hold your hands out for a blessing from our Lord? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace and overwhelm you with the Spirit's love to go out.